You're welcome back to The Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. Sadly, the just, you know, before we came live on air, it's been a heated debate about the Lekki protest. Trust me, in the studio. And glad to know that we're about to bring that heat into dissecting our next topical issue. And it's about the cryptocurrency ban in Nigeria. The Nigerian Senate has invited CBN Governor Gordon Emefiele to the Senate to, you know, of course, speak about this and defend his actions, you know, the ban on cryptocurrency trading in Nigeria. We've invited this morning a chartered accountant and public affairs analyst, Alastair Wilcox. Good morning, sir, and thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. My pleasure.
Okay, let's begin. First of all, where do you stand on this cryptocurrency ban issue? Are you pro or are you against?
I'm not that pro or against. I'm only looking at the issues and the facts of the matter. I stand for national security and the monetary policy stability. So if I have to take it from that angle, then I think the CBN or the monetary regulatory authorities in the country has enough evidences, enough information at their disposal to carry out whatever actions. Not every action carried out benefits every sphere of society. Whatever actions, there must be those who benefit, and those who, as in any policy matter, there must be those who benefit and those who will lose out. The important thing is, let's look at the aggregate, what is the national security interest that is at play as to why such policy will come to form.
Okay, yeah, so just digging into your answer, how does cryptocurrency trading affect monetary policy stability in Nigeria? Could you explain that?
Well, as a matter of fact, if you ask 10 analysts or 10 economists about cryptocurrency, they will give you 10 different answers. Because as of today, cryptocurrency is it's an instrument that is new, that came out not out of the regular monetary system. I have never traded in it before, because really I don't have any specific interest in such, because I do not have understanding of what happens, how you are trading on it, and what happens about. And that is also why a lot of people that jump into it at the, when it came out, a lot of people got their fingers burnt, and a lot of people either lost money or they ran away from it. So it's not something that has, that is something that everybody have understand. For instance, you have understanding of your money, of your regular paper money, you have an understanding of it. You have understanding of how you trade with your money, what you do with your money. But in this case, a lot of people give different diversions. Say it is backed by gold, it is something you buy and it start trading, you can use it for international payment. So there are no specifics. And that is why CBN, central banks or monetary authorities across the globe, has been having sleepless nights as to how to accommodate that aspect of our national finance, international financing model, into their national financial models. So it's been every monetary authorities in the world has been having that challenges and looking at the broad. Yes, instruments are supposed. For instance, we have gold as a measurement of value, as an instrument of exchange. We have other metals as cryptocurrency is trying to take part of it. And there are several aspects. Cryptocurrency is just the broad name. There are several products under this, under the cryptocurrency basket. There are various products, so it's been a challenge. So that is why CBN's, monetary authorities across the world is looking at the pros and cons. Can it be monitored? Can it be regulated? Can it be traced? Can it be tracked? Remember, since 9/11, the world has not been the same in terms of international financing models. That is why you have various laws that came into force. That's why I have jurisdictions are asked to establish anti-corruption agencies, which gave back to our own EFCC and all whatnot, yeah, because of monitoring and movement of funds for destabilization of economies, financing of terrorism, money laundering, and all those financial crimes. So people are looking at this new emergency as in that light. So when it gives headache to monetary authorities, then it's something that everybody needs to take a position
on. So from what you've said, as long as we don't understand it, it's safer to ban it for now or until we understand it?
Not. It's been in operation. Not that they don't have understanding of it, but in terms of regulation, in terms of monitoring, in terms of tracking, in terms of the real worth of those instruments, a lot of people is fraud with a lot of secrecy, a lot of fraud, a lot of misdemeanors.
So why is the government not saying we want to regulate cryptocurrencies?
The government did not ban cryptocurrency in Nigeria. What the CBN did is you cannot transfer your cryptocurrency value into accounts in Nigeria. So you are free to trade your cryptocurrency. Nobody said you should not trade on cryptocurrency. And that's sometimes when news come out, and I always blame journalists, forgive me, in not putting the news in the proper perspective. We, especially in this country, we like to fly news when it comes out. And so the government never banned cryptocurrency. I mean, nobody can ban you from engaging in the business that is legitimate to you, so long as it does not affect national security. But what the government has done is to say, you know, people always transfer their values. That's why you have some of these virtual accounts with some banks. So what people do is to transfer the value. Like I said, I have not participated in cryptocurrency trading. I know where I put my little money. I know the instruments. I put my assets and investments. I know and where I can monitor, where it's transparent and everything. I can be sure when I'm sleeping safely and soundly. So people understand that people always transfer their cryptocurrency values or values into domiciliary accounts in Nigeria and used and make use of. You know, so that is where the government has banned, because some of these monies cannot be traced. There is a lot of, and it is not in Nigeria that has banned it. Some other jurisdictions, even the UK, Exchequer has also placed a serious ban on it. Even the US, the Treasury in the US is having serious issues. They've not come up with that right ban. But jurisdictions across the globe is having a rethink because it distorts national planning. That's for sure. Because since you cannot regulate, sometimes we don't even know how we define a national economy. It's a function of information, data, demand and supply, consumption, and things that you can calculate, you can trace. Now, nobody knows where the sources of these funds come from. Most of them comes from money laundering activity. Most of these funds are...
You can say most. Those are, I guess, assumptions?
No. The monetary authority that knows more than every one of us, I mean, there are thousands and one economists. There are a lot of people who also there will have benefited, because a lot of people... Yes, a lot of people, I will agree, a lot of people have benefited from that trade. A lot of people have got their fingers burnt. I know that there was a time in my small community, in one of my communities, this thing was running everywhere. People were opening accounts, virtual accounts, people were opening. And before 2-3 months, the whole thing collapsed because people lost money.
Because they didn't understand it.
That is the thing. People lost money. And that is one thing Nigeria would do. Some things would not, just so long as they tell you, this is this. And it saddens me when I hear people come to say the government doesn't understand it.
But business is a risk. Even if you invest in the stock market that everybody knows about, if you don't understand the stock market, you can lose.
Well, MMM too was a risk, right? Yes, MMM was a risk, right?
Every business venture is a risk. But there are
ones that are approved, regulated, and can be controlled. Like if you go to the stock market, the issue of the stock market is that you have regulatory control. No one man can wake up and run away with your money. I remember the days of MMM. Let me just say, I remember the days of MMM. On my birthday, December 6th, I was on a program. And that was the issue we talked about. And I told them.
I'm sorry, Mr. Lester, you can never compare a Ponzi scheme of MMM to a digital currency as Bitcoin. I just feel that they're very far-fetched.
No, they're not very far-fetched. We're talking of understanding now. We're talking of understanding. I just told you that a lot of people that went into digital currency, these cryptocurrency businesses, most got their fingers burnt.
Once again, most is what I don't agree with. So you know, because I don't remember, you know, when there was, you know, a crisis all across the world, I'm sure that we would know. We would have heard the same way we heard about MMM. I'm sure we would have known.
Let me tell you why MMM, because it was like a wild wind, and everybody was into it.
Same way a lot of people are into it.
Cryptocurrency, yes. A lot of people went into it because it is virtual. Because it is something that you woke up in the morning, the value has gone so high. You go up the next day. We don't even understand. So that is the issue.
Let's get into the CBN has pointed out, you know, like you said, money laundering, and then also monetary policy, being able to control the outflow of the dollar from Nigeria. Those are, you know, likely some of their fears with the whole cryptocurrency issue. But let's talk about the Senate now, inviting the CBN governor and the Security and Exchange Commission DG. What conversations or what, you know, do you think that this invitation is all about? What do you hope that they, or what do they hope to achieve?
Well, it's normal. When there is a public outcry, the National Assembly always want to flex their muscles and always want to assert their oversight function, which is legitimate. I wish them luck. But the truth of the matter is, do they at the National Assembly, how many of them understand the nitty-gritty of what the CBN is? Well, the CBN will go there and give them their reasons, which is legitimate. And I think there's nothing wrong in National Assembly interview, because I know that a lot of powerful people have interest in the digital money, this cryptocurrency. A lot of powerful people, a lot of institutions have interest in it. And so, and that's why I said from the beginning that when there's a policy, not everybody gains. Now, what we're going to look at is the national overall interest. Look, we have an issue. We have a problem in the country. Our balance of payment is bad. Our foreign reserve is depleting. We are not exporting. We are only an import consuming country. And that is why the value of our currency keep dipping. And so when somebody come and tell me the naira has fallen, hey, brother has done this, I say, look, you are just being, you don't know what you're saying. In a country that you're a consuming economy, you want to consume everything foreign. How will your currency, how will your country get strength? You consume, and as the day goes by, our taste keep expanding. Our taste keep expanding, our population keep increasing. Those who want to get new iPhone 10 are increasing by the day. Because as your ages grow, especially my female folks, as your ages grow, you want to change your phone and to iPhone 12, iPhone 15.
You can't blame people for having taste.
I can blame you for umbrado.
No, Silas, okay. You can't blame people for having taste. You can't necessarily also blame people for not wanting to, you know, purchase locally. Yeah. What we can instead do is expect that the government would have policies and would set
government,
up.
Government is not God.
Because you would expect that, you know, government will create policies, government will create an enabling environment for those things to thrive. Let's look at agriculture.
Yeah.
We've dealt with insecurity for the last 5-6 years. We've dealt with it on levels that we probably had never imagined would happen. Those are things that will affect the production and productivity of Nigerians in different sectors. We've dealt with electricity challenges in ways that it's embarrassing to hear that the giant of Africa is living with this type of electricity. It is not the citizens' fault that they cannot manufacture the things
Let me tell you something. Failure.
Yes.
Excuses. Excuses. The biggest component of failure.
Great.
You can make excuses from now to tomorrow. China was in the worst situation that we were.
Great.
Okay? Years back, China was in the worst situation that we were. China did not take excuse. China did not wait for government. Government is not God. Look, yes, I agree. In this country, do you know the problem we have in this country? We see government as next to God. We want government to feed you in the morning, government feed you in the afternoon, government feed you in the night, government give you free education, government give you free. That is mentality. Let me say this, sir.
I think it's unfair.
Let me say this, sir. They had the ingenuity of Nigerians, those who have succeeded in this country, they also succeeded in this same decadent, dilapidated, unworking. Yet millionaires are growing up every day. There was a time, do you know how many people that made money out of the stock market during this COVID-19? Do you know how many people that made money when everywhere was locked down? Do you know the stock market was booming? Do you know the stock market was booming when everywhere was locked down? Did you see the result posted by companies in the stock market under COVID-19? The same economy, no money came from abroad. No, there was not even investment. You're talking about agriculture. The government is a policy. Do you know the government made so much policy about agriculture that even create protectionism for rice growers? Protectionism for rice growers. Do you know how many field mills we have in the country today? Do you know how many rice mills we have in the country? Do you know the employment? The problem is we don't take time to investigate these things. And no, we are good at complaining. We are good at coming on air and deriding, but we don't take time to investigate. I tell you the problem. We have a problem. The citizens are number one problem. Government did policy to protect local grass of rice. A lot of rice, Nigerian rice, go to the market now. A lot of Nigerian rice are in the market. What do we have? They take advantage. The same Nigerian that they do to protect you, take advantage of that opportunity to milk the same citizen.
Okay.
So we have an unequal society. And until we purge ourselves, of ourselves, of greed, of nepotism, of kill the next man syndrome, we will keep blaming government till thy kingdom come.
So because, our conversation this morning is not about rice.
Yeah. No, it's part of it. Let's bring it back to the topic. See, Mr. Alessio Rehox, I would like us to go back in time to look at the history of money. We all started from where? Was it
Manila?
Metal?
We started with trade by barter.
Exactly, by barter. That was like that was like the earliest form of trade and currency, exchange of value.
Yes.
And then you went to trade in precious metals, we went on to trade in cowries, and then coins, and then paper money.
Yes.
Looking at this trajectory, don't you think that Bitcoin and virtual currencies is the future of money?
No. There's no doubt about it as evolution. Like you said, thank you for that. 101 economics. There's no doubt that there are evolutions in the world, and the world keep evolving. You cannot. But you see, you can't go faster than your shadow. You can't read. You can't from elementary one. Okay, it's primary now. When I did, it was elementary. You can't from primary one or basic. What they call it now? Basic. I don't know. To one, and then you start taking six. In these evolutions, things changes. Like when you say, when they are doing trade by barter, what was the problem they had in trade by barter? Measurement of value. You don't know how many yams can give you a piece of cloth. It depends on haggling price, right? We move to, so they saw a problem in that. So they move to the, they find a solution to it. They move to the next level. And this evolve. We go to Malina, we go to gold and all those. Now we go to paper money that has measurement value. Before, we used to have pounds, shillings, and pence. We go to that level.
Yes.
Now it is pounds and pence, naira and kobo.
Yes.
So these are evolutions. Yes, I agree. And that's why I said monetary authorities over the world are not against cryptocurrencies or virtual monies. No. But you see, what is giving them the headache now is how to make it relevant and safe and secured in terms of national security and world security. Because the issue of terrorism is very, very...
Let me pick on one of your answers. You mentioned talking about security for transactions.
Yes.
Do you have any idea, just how much money laundering or theft or criminal activities are conducted worldwide every day with our credit card?
No, sure.
Credit card theft, yes. Credit card fraud.
No.
I think crime would always exist, whether it's Bitcoin or whether it's dollar or whatever.
Crime will exist. And that is why it is that your card keep having innovations, right? Your card.
Mm-hmm.
When our cards came out, the security features were not as it is. Hackers were easily to hack and all whatnot. And that's the challenge. So it keep happening. So there will be criminals. The criminals will not go away. They are not going away today. The children that are going to be born this year, in the next 20 years, most of them will become criminals.
Almost again. Jesus.
Few of them will become criminals. Again, depending on how the society is. If the society is done, are wider open to encourage this crime.
Crime will always exist. Yeah,
And that is why you must keep taking preemptive actions to minimize, not eradicate. Okay? Even Switzerland, the one with the least prison, the sea of prison, and the sea of police. So there'll still be crime. So that's what I'm saying is that we must not see everything government does in the light of it's not favoring the citizen. If government cannot control the economy, it will create inflation. You now blame government. It will create scarcity, you not blame government. It will create crime. Because if there is too much influx of illicit funds from nowhere, where sources they cannot really trace, and then you are mates, both of you left university the same day. I'm just being in the school, you are the one giving him, he was on 001 or 10 or 010, and you are the one that was supporting the driver, and he's still, tomorrow he's seeing by the houses in Lekki. Some of that people get, so will get so angry. Say, well, how come the guy escorted this man to Nigeria? And you don't know any visible means of income that he's doing. So it could create crime, it could create more disturbance. So nobody says they are banning cryptocurrency. They've not banned it. People are free to trade on their asset. I understand that you can use cryptocurrency to buy goods, exchange goods and services. That's the means of exchanges. But what the government says, please, you can't transfer the values into virtual accounts in Nigeria.
But you know, like we've seen on social media, this would just be another way to even, you know, increase the revenue for other countries or make the economies better for countries like Ghana, because they've mentioned that they would open Ghana bank accounts and transfer it, you know, convert it to
Ghana will not.
We can't really say.
Let me tell you something. CBN's that when I say the UK exchequer banned it, you see, financial institutions, no financial center across the world, apart from those rogue states, there are a lot of rogue states we have in this country. I don't want to mention any country's name. There are states where they encourage money laundering, open free account, get citizenship, and all that. Apart from those, and those states are always at the radar of the International Financial Crime Commissions. So apart from those states, not a state like Ghana that is also battling with their own set of problems that people will not boast in open Ghana. You see, do people think that Ghana is just an open economy? Ghana is my second home.
All right.
And I can tell you a few things about Ghana. So do people think that Ghana is just a place you walk across and do all kinds of things? The things you do in Nigeria and get away. You can't do it in, you can't even think it in Ghana. And you think you get away with it.
Quickly, what do we, I need to, you know, I need to just wrap up with the conversation on the Senate once again. Many times we've seen them summon government officials and heads of agencies. Not very often that we get to see results. And so should we look at this, or should Nigerians ignore this invitation as just one of, you know, part of the whole process that may not bring anything, you know, fruitful?
No, you don't. You see, informations are key. The policy that came out from the CBN is just a policy. There's no underlining revelations as informations, what they have, what reasons for it. So I think those reasons will be presented to the, those informations and the reasons will be presented to the Senate.
They've given their reasons. They're saying trafficking.
That is broad now. That is broad. You just put one guideline. I mean, in school, we said, name this. You put the now write the essay. So the essay will be made known to the
you mean a report?
Our respected legislators.
Okay.
They will be adequately informed. They will see the facts of the matter. They will see the pros and the cons. And let's give it to our CBN. They may not be, we may not have all the best, but I think we have some of the best brains.
Does the Senate have the powers quickly? Do they have the powers to ask the CBN to reverse these bonuses?
No. This is an administrative. This is not a what do you call it now? A legislative issue.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. It's an administrative issue.
Okay.
What they will do is to get information and be able to help the country again.
Okay.
Inform their constituents.
Mm-hmm.
This is the reason why the country take this, and this is why the CBN, and let's follow them. Please trade in your cryptocurrency. Trade in it. Nobody says you should not trade in it. And you know, a lot of people do not have this information. Trade in it. I've spoken about this in other medias, and I've told Nigerians, nobody banned cryptocurrency trading. You are free to trade it. But please, what the CBN said, don't bring the pros into your virtual accounts, and we don't know, out of all this, we don't know who will bring in illicit money to fund Boko Haram, to fund all kinds of instability that we have in the country.
The thing now is we just can't wait to see the outcome of this Senate meeting with CBN governors.
They will talk and they will get information.
We can't wait, because definitely there are senators who are against it and there are some who are for it. I mean, there's this one co-sponsor of a motion, Senator Abiru, representing APC Lagos East, he said the economic benefits associated with cryptocurrencies cannot be eroded by the central bank's ban. So we'll just have to wait.
He's a banker. He just left the bank. So he's a banker. So he also have good information because he's a banker. He just left as the bank. The CBN too has people like him that has first-hand information after the problem. So let's see who has a bigger pie.
Alistair Wilcox is a chartered accountant. He says Nigerians need to wake up the same way the Chinese woke up and stop blaming government all the time. Good morning to you once again. Thanks for joining us so far.
It's always my pleasure. Nice discussion. I love this.
Yes.
Thanks for joining us on Breakfast. If you missed out on any parts of this conversation, join us on social media. It's at Plus TV Africa on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and on our YouTube channel also. Thanks to Aneta also. It's been a great week.
Yes. So have a great weekend and happy Valentine's Day in advance.